here today. I'm Bishop Craig Hedman, I'll be conducting President Bryce Adams, former state presidency, presiding at this celebration of life for Sister Bethea Hanny, July 27, 1954 to November 11, 2022. Today is Saturday, November 26, 2022, with the care of our family. Prayer was offered already by Sister Adriana Lynch. Our organist will be Sister Zoe Harper. Paul bearers for this services will be Mark Andrews, Marcus Ray, Chris Thatcher, Kendra Kenny, Lauren Gilder, Austin Hanny, Devin Merritt, Casey Lynch. The floral tribute is from the grandchildren. We'll begin our services today with an invocation by Caitlin Thatcher, followed by a song, I Will Walk With Jesus, by the grandchildren.
She taught us, for the way she lived, for her passion and zest for life and adventure, for the love that she showed to everyone, the way that she pulled everyone in and mothered and grandmothered them. We thank you for her legacy. Please help us to take those memories and those feelings with us. Help it to stick with us that we might change and keep her a part of us. Please help us to keep her memories alive and to continue the legacies that she taught us. Please comfort all who are grieving, that they might feel her close, that they might receive peace, and that we can feel comfort, that we can be with her again. We're so grateful for all the time that we have had with her, and we mourn the time
have a key light sketch by Melanie Ray and Caroline Gilbert. Following that, we'll listen to a musical recording, like our first song is The Nans. Following the musical recording, we'll hear from Sister Cheryl Marsden and Kendrick Hanny. Following both Hanny's remarks, we'll have the song O Divine Redeemer by Tony Meekham and Doreen Fredrickson. And our benediction will be given by Chris America.
Mom taught us how to tell the best stories, and the best story we will ever tell is that of our moms. Anna Bethea Hanny was born July 27, 1954, to loving parents Ray and Maxine Andrews. She was the second of six children, two brothers and three sisters, Trina, Mark, Sally, Susan, and Bruce. Her family lived in a little farmhouse in Austin, Idaho. Maxine had found the name Bethea in a novel she was reading and liked the sound of the name. When I asked my grandmother why she named Mom Anna but called her Bethea, she said, well, Bethea Anna didn't sound as good. Anna Bethea just has such a ring to it. Even with this special ring to her name, Maxine just called her Bippy Doll. When Mom was a grandmother herself, we never once heard Maxine call her Bethea. In 1965, the family moved into an older home, an older house in Hammond, where Bethea spent the rest of her childhood. To the children, it was like moving into a castle. This is where Mom learned to ride a bike, play hopscotch, make mud pies, and do artwork with sidewalk chalk. Bethea is remembered fondly for the fun she brought to the family throughout her life. She loved running through the water on the lawn when her dad, Ray, flooded and irrigated from the canal. Ray was active in home responsibilities, and she had a special connection with him. They would spend hours later in life discussing flowers and being excited about the catalog of new iris bulbs being released. Ray and Bethea anticipated the arrival of these new bulbs and planted them in their yards, admiring them together throughout the years. Bethea's sister Trina shared that they washed dishes together as children do. The rule then was that dishes that could fit in a dish drainer could air dry, so the two spent more time balancing and fitting the dishes in the drainer than they actually did if they had just dried them in the towel. However, later in life, this skill came in incredibly handy with a dishwasher. She found a way of utilizing every available inch when loading the dishes. You know, she was able to fit more dishes inside a dishwasher than anyone I've ever known. And although I've heard many complaints about this, about her technique, this is actually just how a dishwasher should be loaded. The Andrews sisters would take turns scratching each other's backs and talking to each other at night. One night, Trina just stopped responding because she had fallen asleep. Mom always was a night owl, though. She would continue reading her book under the covers with a flashlight, even when she was married and had her own home. Bethea attended schools, Hillview Elementary, Hammond Junior High, and Bonneville High School, graduating in 1972. She was active in many clubs, including drama, pep, lesbian club as the officer secretary treasurer, a medical careers officer, and active in concert choir. She always was the life of the party and loved serving in so many organizations. Later, she acted in community plays with her children, introducing them to her interests and sharing her love of theater by doing so. During her teenage years, Bethea became the favorite babysitter in the neighborhood because she was so much fun. One year, her ward youth group went on a bus trip to church history sites in Nauvoo with other church members and stayed with other church members along the way. On their way home, she decided one of those families needed a nanny, and so she stayed with their children for the rest of the summer. It was just like her to be up for an adventure. It was definitely spontaneous. Mom attended Ritz College and graduated in 1974 with an associate's degree in nursing. Both her mother and her grandmother had been nurses, and it was in their blood, as I had heard. After graduation, she worked at Elkins Hospital in Idaho Falls on a medical unit and was remembered for her caring and gentleness during her time as a registered nurse. Bethea was introduced to Merrill Grant Hanny at a young girl fireside. His cousin, Jana, worked with Maxine and had actually attended nursing school with Trina. Jana had gotten to know my mom during a 3-week church history tour. She tells the story that mom was looking for someone to date someone, and Merrill was looking for a wife, so naturally she introduced them. After a short courtship of 3 weeks, they were engaged. On November 7, 1975, they were sealed for time and all eternity in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, Idaho Falls Temple. Merrill said about Bethea, quote, "I was absolutely smitten with her beauty and charm the first time I met her. I knew that I was way outclassed and never dreamed that I would marry someone on her level. I was really surprised when she consented to marry me. I thought the deal of a century," close quote. They had just celebrated 47 years together and were on an anniversary trip at the time of her death. Mom loved the new little family she and Dad were raising in a small red farmhouse in Roberts, Idaho. The couple welcomed Melanie Joe, Carolyn Ray, Kendrick Merrill, and Sharisa Bethea.
Sharisa died on September 27th, 1985. From health-related issues. Mom taught us compassion and love at an early age as we cared for Sharisa for a few short months. In 1985, Merrill and Bethea decided to move their family to Taylor. This decision brought them a community with many new lifelong friendships over the past 37 years. Their home in Taylor was a project, and they worked diligently on the project as they planned and oversaw, and at times physically built part of their new home. We remember having a spontaneous campout on Mom and Dad's soon-to-be bedroom floor for reasons as adults we don't remember. A few blankets from the car were pulled out and used. I am sure that it wasn't that comfortable laying on the floor in my parents' bedroom. But we thought it was the most magical adventure ever. Bethea and Merrill welcomed their other 5 children while living here, Carissa Nicole, Caitlin Suzanne, Angelina Pita, Austin Mitchell Grant, and Adriana Bethea. Angelina tragically was stillborn. This difficult part of her story is retold in the words of our dad, quote, "Bethea's greatest trial in life was the loss of Angelique. She was so heartbroken, physically, emotionally, and mentally that she had to withdraw from the world for about 2 years. I didn't think we'd be able to survive as a family. The real message is that she found a way to survive, heal, and eventually cry." Bethea went on to bear 2 more children, though the real healing wasn't complete until Aubrey was born.
beyond quietly supporting and lifting others in their times of grief and need. Dad remarked, quote, my greatest pleasure was providing a living for Bethea and her family. A man will work tirelessly providing for his family. Likewise, a mother knows no limits caring for her precious children. It's amazing what a man and woman can accomplish in this life working together, close quote. Mom and Dad loved to turn on the radio and dance in the kitchen. They were accomplished dancers, as many of you probably can attest to. We would watch in amazement, anxiously awaiting for our turn to dance with them. We would beg them for one more dance until they were finally too tired or out of breath to keep going. Thanks to my mom, holidays, especially Christmas, were made magical. She loved decorating the Christmas tree and placing her kids' homemade ornaments on the branches. Even after we were grown, she still placed those same ornaments on her tree every year. Last year, my mom and dad and I were visiting a glass blowing shop in Venice, Italy. We reminisced about a family childhood favorite Christmas ornament. It was a small glass light manger with Mary, Joseph, and Christ. We pined over how it broke after decades of child admiration and helpfulness when decorating the tree. As we turned the corner, we discussed. We found the most similar replica either of us had ever seen. And after looking at the tiniest of details of the differences in the five that were displayed, she bought two, one for herself and one for me. This year, this precious ornament will hold a deeper meaning to me in my heart as I place it on my tree. Mom always had a special place in her heart for cats. Her favorite cats were those that looked like Siamese. She would care for stray cats who just showed up at their house. I cannot count how many newborn kittens she bottle-fed until they were strong enough to rejoin their litter mates. We just thought this is something that mothers did. Bethea was an avid reader and passed this love to her children. A good novel and a box of Red Hots were the perfect match. Her night owl self would come out and Mom would stay up until the early morning hours, captivated by the storyline in the book. She also enjoyed listening to audiobooks of mysteries and dramas. During family road trips, when we were children, she would read books to us. There were now seven of us, and she had to read loudly so that the kids in the back of the vehicle could hear over the roar of the engine. She was so incredibly talented with her captivating narration. How she was able to read so animatedly and not lose her voice is hard to comprehend. When she would pause to take a rest, we would complain and beg her to read more. She would take a drink or a bite of apple and the story would continue with the same vibrance. As a grandmother, she had collected a bookshelf full of children's books and read to her grandchildren every chance she got. Instilling in them the same love for books that she had. Mom had an innate love of gardening, and every year, Mom and Dad would grow a big vegetable garden, resulting in a harvest that had to basically be shared with anyone who happened to be stopping by. She enjoyed canning or freezing the homegrown produce, including green beans, tomatoes, peaches, and corn. Her strawberry raspberry freezer jams were absolutely delicious, still coveted by her adult children. Bethea was often seen wearing her flip-flops and sun visor while outside watering her beloved flower pots and hanging baskets that lined the deck and porch. She loved flowers.
Mom had a special love for the iris flowers that she and her father would order and plant in my parents' yard. She also had a beautiful rose garden that she lovingly cared for. Some of these rose bushes held deep meaning to her. She would make an arrangement and place them at the headstones of her two infant daughters. In the summer months, Bethea could be found walking the country roads with friends. And you know, I have never seen anybody be able to speed walk as fast as my mom could. I tried it with her. I tried it. She cherished the time that she spent with those friends and her friends as they would go to lunch and enjoy some time together to celebrate special occasions. Summer nights would find my parents out checking water pumps in the fields, then sitting on the deck in their yard talking about the day while enjoying a salad from Costa Rica. Mom loved how her feet helped my dad, and they would watch as they would watch the last rays of the sun disappear, or really, anytime they were sitting near one another. Over the years, she and Meryl enjoyed the hobby of riding horses. They often went horseback riding on day and night trips in the backcountry as a couple, with their children, or with friends. My parents were frequently seen driving the horse and carriage around the Taylor community. Mom enjoyed fishing at local lakes and rivers with her family. In the winter, it was snowmobiling and cross-country skiing. And when Snow and her grandkids were involved, there was sure to be hot chocolate and a warm fire after. Mom looked forward to family events, especially making and sharing a meal. She loved desserts. Let me say that again. She loved desserts and was an incredible baker. If any of you have had a chance to taste our mom's baked goods, it was incredible. She made the most delicious sweets, fudge, cherry squares, and caramel popcorn. It was hard to replicate her recipes, since she knew just how much extra something to add. A spoonful of cookie dough was always would always find its way to an eager child each time she mixed up a batch of cookies. Mom loved to go camping and would take us tent camping for up to a week at a time when we were young. That was brave. Our traditional spot was Brenna Hot Springs in Wyoming, where we have gone each summer for over 35 years. This continued to the next generation as the grandkids excitedly looked forward to each summer, knowing she would spoil them. There was always scavenger hunts, skimming rocks in the river, swimming in the natural hot pools, searching out names of wildflowers in her reference book, and just being present with family. Her fortitude paid off each time she made a s'more. She would patiently roast the marshmallow to a light, golden brown perfection before adding the chocolate and graham cracker. Her s'mores making skills came in handy with so many of us in the family, anxiously accepting her generous offer for her to make us just the perfect s'more. When Maxine was still living, Mom made sure that she and the motorhome made it up to Granite to enjoy their favorite camping spot together and join in the activities. Mom was always up for a game of marbles, the game board made by her dad, or really any game that when a family member wanted to play, always patient when teaching the younger children the rules of the game and assisting them in playing. However, Mom had a competitive streak in her. She didn't like to lose and would ask for a rematch anytime she lost, which wasn't very often, to be honest. Now, Bethea drove her car with purpose, accompanied with a left foot on the gas pedal. She could be seen flying down the country roads as she was typically running a few minutes late and trying to make up time. The local police officers also tracked her speed and left their reminder by a ticket to slow down, but somehow that didn't stop her left foot on the pillow, or on the pedal, excuse me. Although, you know, as I think about it, it may have actually just been a problem with her vehicle because I'm driving her car now and I'm having the same problem. Whenever I look at a lemon, I will always think of my mom. She loved lemons in her water, just how many lemon slices she could fit into a glass of water. She also loved meringue pie and really anything sour. Being the wife of a farmer meant there was a lot of work to be done around the home and in the fields. During harvest, it was common to find her sorting potatoes with fresh, manicured nails. She spent hours writing with her children while holding grandchildren on her lap in the potato truck. For all who worked in the potato harvest, the delicious homemade treats she made and brought were a welcome highlight. While we were growing up, Mom made sure we had opportunities to learn music, how to cook, swim, and dance, and so many other things. But most importantly, she taught her kids about Jesus Christ. She had great faith that He makes it possible for families to be together forever. Bethea has such a strong testimony and love of our Savior and served in various church callings throughout her life. Her sister Susan, known to us as Aunt Susie, shared, quote, "One year, when we were living in Illinois, Bethia and her family came for Thanksgiving. We had a wonderful time. After dinner, Bethia and I went for a walk. Bethia said, 'We are told that God won't give us more than we can bear. I don't know if that is true.'" Susie continues, "I was so surprised and have always remembered that, because sometimes we can't see the incredible strength inside of us." Her core was forged from gold and steel. She had the ability to care for others in ways no one else could. Close quote. One by one, her children left home, started their own adventures, careers, and families. Two of her daughters followed in her footsteps by earning their degrees as a registered nurse, making four generations of nurses. The other three daughters also pursued careers in healthcare. Her two sons took a business path, which is just crazy. Was her life calling of being a grandma. She quickly adopted the title of Brahma, and that's how she said it, really, Brahma. The love and attention she felt and expressed for each of her 19 grandchildren is indescribable. She would lovingly call her granddaughters Dolly, a term of endearment that she had once used with her own girls. She would drop everything to play dress up, pretend, or to be found head deep in a ball pit with her grandkids. Whenever possible, she attended birthday parties, recitals, and sporting events. Mom was dedicated to both her children and grandchildren, traveling often to see them, no matter how far away they lived. Bethea learned to crochet years ago from friends in the area. Anytime a new grandbaby was announced in the family, Mom would crochet a special baby blanket, one small huggy blanket, and one bigger when the grandchild was older. They could wrap themselves in it. Mom spent hours researching what color of yarn and what pattern each daughter or daughter-in-law of the new baby wanted, until she found the perfect match. Her skill of crocheting grew with each new grandchild born. These blankets had to be perfect. And she spent hours crocheting, unpicking, and re-crocheting until the blanket was acceptable to her and the new grandbaby. Of course, the best part of being grandma was putting her grandkids to bed and reading a bedtime story. Although with this one story, we're turning to 10. And the grandkids were always up much later than their bedtimes. As Bethea's grandchildren, you will always cherish the special and unique memories and relationships you have developed with Grandma. Grandma is so proud of each of you. She loves each of you more than you could know.
Someone to love
beyond that, very little matters. Mom was the quiet and consistent glue of our family. We were loved by her deeply. She will be dearly missed. We want to share with you the love that Mom had for all of you. She touched each one of you in some way. That's why you're here today. To remember what she meant to you. To share memories of her with others and with her family. And to celebrate her life. Mom always had a way of living. She knew how to live and to make the most of the moments she had.
Say goodbye to Mom.
It's been a very difficult thing to do. Representing her life, to memorialize and celebrate her is an honor in my mind. I see her hugging and saying goodbye to us as we get into our cars to return to our homes here in the barn, our jobs, our children, and our own adventures. She would always stand in the doorway until we turned onto the road and were out of sight. Someday, we will see her standing at the door, waiting to welcome us with her bright and excited, "You're home!" Because to her, we were home. This story of our mom doesn't end here, because it has just begun in mind.
Our lives are Tell what your family to know how much you are loved and cared for. Your family has shown over and over again Christ-like love to this community, to anybody that you come in contact with. There are many dear who have been receivers of the kindness and love that you and the people.
At that time, we started walking daily.
Bethea was determined that nothing would interfere with those walks every day except Sundays. In the dead of winter, we would walk 5 miles through rain and snow. I figured that the course of 3 years, we walked thousands of miles. Those walks were filled with sound advice, an opportunity to share triumphs and sorrows in our testimonies. When my son passed away, the thief didn't wait to ask help. She just did what she was always doing. She stepped in. While I was in the hospital, she came and got my kids, all 6 of them, took them to her house, and kept them. She then cleaned my house top to bottom and stocked my kitchen. She always knew exactly what I needed. I loved her, loved for others. When the thief decided you were her friend, you were her friend no matter what. There are so many qualities that the thief had and shares. Sometimes I thought, and this was her really side, my aunt would ask her, Thea, are you joking or are you serious? And she would look at me and say, you know me, Cheryl, I'm just joking. And then she would laugh. There was a time we were going to the gym. We were taking a body pump class that we really liked. One day I said, okay, let's try a spinning class. So we did. After a couple of days, we were so sore. She said, I am done with that class. I don't want to go back. And she left on vacation. And I decided to go back and try the class again. She came home from vacation, and I told her she had to go to the class with me. She was not happy. But we continued to go for a very long time. Anytime I would say, why are we doing this? She would look at me and say, this is your fault. The theater was helpful. There were so many who have received help for courage. And the help she has given was given in love. She sat with a couple where her husband was going through an illness. She volunteered to help watching kids. She was there for her friends to lift and encourage. The thief's calling was in the Relief Society. And she told me not long ago, that I hope you don't refuse me, because I have really enjoyed that time. This summer, my family went on a trip. All of our kids, except for my daughter and her husband, and her doctor advised her not to go because she was doing it for the baby. The baby knew I was worried, and so every day, she would call my daughter and see how, text my daughter to see how she was doing. Again and again, my kids have said, if anything happens to you, Mom and Dad, we know where we can go. We can go to the Hanny's. Bethea was determined. Yes, she was stubborn, and I loved her for that. I watched Bethea as she faced struggles with her own health. But she was still determined to reach out to others, giving no upon herself. And how she was doing. She wanted to serve, but most importantly, that service was in love. Her famous saying was, I'm good. Bethea was obedient. Her obedience and love of the gospel was strong. She loved the church and wanted to do those things that show obedience in living and being on that public path. She was faithful. She was faithful to her family, her friends, her community. She loved and had faith in our Savior, Jesus Christ. She had a strong faith, a strong testimony. She had faith in Meryl as the husband and the leader of their home and the things that they were doing. Our greatest quality and gift gave us, the leader gave us, was a portion of her. The way that she was living, helpful, determined, obedient, faithful, was an example to all of us. I loved her for the example she was to me and to my husband. President, you have said, I quote,
suffering, we become happier, more peaceful, and more receptive to the whispering of the Holy Ghost. The Savior wants each of us to learn that humility and service are worthy characteristics we should seek and attain. He taught that no one is too important to serve others. If we truly are disciples of Jesus Christ, we need to reach out with love and understanding to all, to our neighbors and most importantly to our families. Bethea followed these examples of the Savior. Bethea heard, I see the place God made her so amazing. I praise Him for the blessings of her friendship and for her being a part of my life and all of our lives. My favorite song is found in the prayer, and I would like to read that to you. Each life that touches the hearts of good reflects thy own prayers and glory. God, send us blessings from above through words and deeds of those who love. What greater gift dost thou bestow? What greater goodness can we know than Christ-like friends whose gentle ways strengthen our faith and reach our needs? When such a friend from us departs, we hold forever in our hearts a sweet and holy memory. Bring this mirror, Lord, to thee. For worthy friends whose lives proclaim devotion to the Savior's name, who blesses our days with peace and love, we praise thy goodness, Lord above. There is no greater reward that we can come, but that can come to any of us, is a sincere thank you for being a friend, for being a brother or a sister or a man or an uncle or a mother and a father. Thank you. To be of my heart, for being my friend, for being a kindred spirit in my life, I love you. We all love you. I'm sharing you my testimony, but I know our Savior loves each and every one of you. He is there for each one of us in these times to be comforted. May you feel His loving arms around you as you go through these times. Thank you, Bethea. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Mothers give life and give their life for their children. Jesus gave His life to restore physical bodies through the power of resurrection. Because of His great gift, all mankind will be resurrected, the righteous, the wicked, and even those that have never heard of Jesus Christ, all will receive this great gift of the resurrection. In Alma 11:44 it says, now this restoration shall come to all, both old and young, both bond and free, both male and female, both the wicked and the righteous, and even there shall not be as much as a hair of their heads lost, but everything shall be restored to its perfect frame. It's comforting to know, after all my mom's been through, that her spirit and her body will be resurrected to a perfect state, and that she will live again. In Matthew 28, an angel told Mary, fear not, not. For I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. I'm grateful for the resurrection made possible by the Savior. Because moms love their children, they want, and their cute grandchildren, they want us to come home and visit often. They want to come see us. They want their entire family to come home for Thanksgiving. Well, we all came home for Thanksgiving, but this is not what we had in mind. Moms won't force us to come home and visit them. Although if you knew my mom, you knew she was stubborn and a little bit persistent. My mom loved when her children would come home for potato harvest, summer vacations at grandma, and for the holidays. She also made sure to visit each one of her children and grandchildren as often as possible. Our heavenly parents want us to come home when our time on this earth is through. Heavenly Father won't force us to return and live with him, but he does teach us the way through scriptures and prophets and invites us to follow his Son, Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Ghost. All he asks us to do is to keep his commandments and follow his Son so that we can overcome spiritual death and return to live with him. In John 14, Jesus says, "He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him." In DNC 132, Jesus taught us, "For strait is the gate, and narrow the way that leadeth unto exaltation, and the continuation of the lives, and few there be that find it, because you receive me not in the world, nor do you know me. But if you receive me in the world, then shall you know me, and shall receive your exaltation, that where I am shall be also. This is eternal lives, to know the only wise and true God, and Jesus Christ, whom he hath sent." Jesus is our advocate with the Father, and he wants us to have eternal life. The greatest gift of all, he made this possible through his atonement. As I was thinking about my mom and preparing for this talk, I was talking with my brother Austin, and he said, "Hey, why don't you open mom's scriptures and just see if she had any important verses that she highlighted." And so I'll share with you the first two verses that the page is just open to. I didn't even know what I would find there, but it was interesting. The first one is found in Alma chapter 32:21. It says, "Faith is not to have a perfect knowledge of things. Therefore, if you have faith, you hope for things which are not seen, which are true." Mom had faith in our Heavenly Father's plan, and she taught us to follow him. Many of us might be like the Father, desiring his Son to be healed in Mark, that said, "Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief." But life does not always work out how we'd like it to. In 1983, my parents lost their 3-year-old daughter, Teresa. They were heartbroken. This is one of the hardest deaths they would ever deal with. In 1990, my mom lost her 7-child grandchildren at birth. She and my father were devastated. Mom was frustrated, full of grief, and she was angry. To make matters worse, she lost her kind father suddenly 2 years later, in 1992, when he was only 61. She went through a very dark period of her life for several years. In Ether 6, we learn, "You receive no witness until after the trial of your faith." Mom and Dad's faith was sorely tried. Each of us deal with different challenges in our lives. The Savior knows how to help us through these difficult times. Not only can we help us overcome our sins, but he can also heal us from our grief and sorrows. In Alma 7, it says, "And he will take upon him death, that he may loose the bands of death which bind his people, and he will take upon him their infirmities, that his bowels of mercy may be filled according to the flesh, that he may know according to the flesh how to suffer his people according to their infirmities." My mom saved my life. She held me in her arms one night for several hours when I felt like I could not go on anymore because of poor decisions that I had made in my life. She helped me see the bigger picture and believe in myself again. The Savior knows our pains and sorrows, and he can heal each one of our hearts. He will pick you up and carry you in his arms. Because Mom was acquainted with so much pain in her life, she was quick to serve others in need. To save the peace of the family, be humble and wash each other's feet through service. In Messiah, it says, how loved the man the master whom he had not served. Mom knew the Savior and his love through her constant service to others. Mom washed many of our feet, including my own family. And when my wife was in critical care last year after the birth of our son, Mom quickly came to our aid, asking how she could help each day, and selflessly served our family for months until Andrew recovered. She also enjoyed being a compassionate service leader, talking with others, and serving them. One of Mom's greatest talents was to look upon the heart of each individual and see their worth. It made us so uncomfortable that she would talk to complete strangers for 20 minutes at a time. But she truly saw their worth, and she did as she did for each of us. She cared about each of us and her grandchildren one by one. And Samuel says, for the Lord seeth not as a man seeth, for the man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Jesus died for each one of us. When he visits the marriages, he asked each individual to come up one by one and feel the prints of the nails in his hands and in his feet, so that they could know that he died for them. Mom, I know that Jesus loves you, and that he will show himself to you. Jesus loves us, and is our advocate with Father, to help us return home. When we stand before Heavenly Father the last day, we'll be humbled to hear these words. Father, behold the sufferings and the death of him who did no sin, in whom thou hast well pleased. Behold the blood of thy Son which was shed, the blood of him whom thou hast gave us, that thy Son might be glorified. Wherefore, Father, spare these my brethren that believe on my name, that they may come unto me and have everlasting life. Moms love their children unconditionally. They're patient with us and forgive us when we make mistakes. Mom's greatest desire in life was to have her eternal family together forever. This was especially important to her because she lost her daughters, her mother, her father, and her brother that had gone before her. She was faithful to the gospel of Jesus Christ and the covenants that she made so that she could see them again and live with her family eternally. You live worthy of that, Mom. Thank you for your faith and example. I'm sure that you will hear the words spoken in Matthew, well done, my good faithful servant, enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Each one of you are part of our Heavenly Father's family. It doesn't matter what we have done wrong, how old we are, it doesn't matter how many talents we've been given, if you're rich or poor, the things of the world. Heavenly Father just wants us to have a humble heart, to love with all our hearts, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. We come under Christ, follow his commandments, and return to our heavenly home. Because of the power of the atonement, we can return home for our heavenly thanksgiving. We don't know when our last day on earth will be. This is the time now to prepare for the journey home and help others along the way. The last scripture, second scripture that fell over my mom's book was in DNC 138, 12 through 15. And they were gathered together in one place, an innumerable company of spirits of the just, who had been faithful in the testimony of Jesus while they lived in mortality, and who had offered sacrifice in the similitude of the great sacrifice of the Son, and had suffered tribulation in every human name. All these had departed the mortal life, firm in the hope of a glorious resurrection through the grace of God, Father, and his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. I beheld that they were filled with joy and gladness, and were rejoicing together because the day of their deliverance was at hand. Mom, I know that you will be resurrected, that your spirit and body will join together, and that I can see you again today. I love you, my sweet Mom. Thank you for teaching me to see the Lord, for teaching the visual on the inside. Thank you for forgiving me over and over and over again. Thank you for your testimony of the Savior and for not doing this. Thank you for not giving up on life. Even when it was hard. Thank you for your great example and for living faithfully. I will try to live worthy of your example and love. You are my sweet angel, love and love. Mom has lots of bigger things. She's with her daughters and her family. And although her body, always there before us, good works and kindness and love live on in our hearts. But she's alive today. She is doing great things with her daughters and family on the other side of the bed. And she will be with you when you have needs. She can come and help us and help us. I love you, Mom. Moms are truly special. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.